And if large amounts of gravity can bend space, large amounts of gravity can bend time too.
Greetings, welcome back. Mike Hill here, and you're watching Futurist World, your home for big ideas about the future and emerging profiles of what tomorrow may hold. Today, get ready to have your minds blown, because we're sitting down with particle physicist, CERN investigator, and popular futurist, Dr. James Beacham on the future of time. James swung past our office here in Melbourne, Australia during a recent visit down under for a keynote at ForceFest. Originally from the Midwest USA, James is now a researcher on the Atlas experiment at the Large Hadron Collider at CERN in Switzerland. The LHC is a 27-kilometer supercooled, vacuum-sealed, ringed megastructure that runs underground, crossing the borders of Switzerland and France. How cool is that? Well, according to James, that's still way too small to test his really big ideas. But deep in his underground lair, he's looking for new phenomena and explanations for some of the key unsolved mysteries of the universe. He's a brilliant public speaker who, like Arthur C. Clarke, challenges his audience to take a step past the limits of the possible by going beyond them into the impossible. James believes every curious human is secretly a particle physicist and very much enjoys talking about physics with non-specialists like me. So turn up your processing power, make sure your flux capacitor is fully charged, and get ready to choose a way cooler future. And remember, if you don't want to miss a particle, subscribe to our podcast at Futurist World today.
Thanks for having me.
Future of time, this is going to blow my mind. But first, time, what is it?
You've asked one of the most difficult sticky questions in the history of physics. Because time, it seems like we understand it quite well. Everyone experiences time. We're going through time right now. But what does it mean? How do you define what time even is? In a physics sense, there's a lot of way, people have attempted a lot of things to try to define what time really is. In a kind of pure basic sense, time is a parameter. I know that's not satisfying to a lot of people, but what it is, it's a thing that we can put in our physics equations that allows us to evolve things so that there's like a sequence of events. Otherwise it doesn't make any sense. So in a sense, the easiest possible thing to say is that time is a parameter, but that's a very nerdy thing to say. Time also can be defined as the direction in which entropy increases. Also a very nerdy thing to say. But what that means is that, as you know, entropy is a sort of a measure of the disorder of stuff. And you can have entropy on smaller scales around us right now. The entropy is pretty low because everything's ordered. There's a wall here. It's nicely, the table is solid. But in the middle of outer space, you know, maybe entropy is a little bit higher. On average, though, the entire universe has a certain amount of entropy. And it seems that this is always going in one direction toward more and more entropy. But you can define time as the direction in which the entropy of the universe increases. It's also a coordinate, right? Time is a coordinate. So think about how we ever define something like an event in the universe, an event being something that happened, right? To specify any event, you need to specify at least four pieces of information, right? Three spatial coordinates.
Okay.
Let's say you're meeting for a friend for coffee in Manhattan, right? You have to specify the north-south street, east-west street, and like the floor, maybe the cafe is on the 30th floor, right?
Yep.
You also have to specify one more piece of information. What time?
Yeah.
It doesn't make any sense otherwise. So that means, in that sense, it's a coordinate that allows us to define events in this larger framework of the entire universe.
So, James, if time's a parameter and a coordinate, how well do we understand it compared to other parameters and coordinates?
We understand it quite well because the fun part about it is that if you think about these other coordinates, you know, these three spatial dimensions, I can go forward and backward in these spatial dimensions, but I can't go backwards in time. I can't choose.
Yeah.
We also know that just like the other spatial coordinates, time can be bent just like spatial coordinates can. And so in that sense, even though time seems to be like kind of the odd man out in terms of coordinates, it's just like the others. Because at the extremes, like when there's a lot of gravity, when, you know, as you know from general relativity, right? What is gravity? Gravity is what happens when you take enough stuff, energy, density, mass, like a big planet or a, you know, black hole, and you put it into a small enough space, the presence of that stuff bends the fabric of space-time.
Right.
So, you know, so you, the analogy, like you have a rubber sheet that's completely flat, and if I put a little marble on it, it doesn't deform very much. But if I put a big bowling ball on it, it deforms quite a bit. And from the point of view of like a small like photon or something, if you're going, photon always wants to go in a straight direction. It's always going straight and thinks that it's going straight.
This is a light beam.
Yeah, like a light beam, right. But if you look from above, like a big star, a photon that goes around it will bend a bit. Yeah. We can see this from gravitational lensing. We'll see like this, you know, this effect of seeing this thing twice. It's still straight from the photon's perspective, but from a different perspective, it's bending because the fabric of space-time, space has bent itself.
Yeah.
And if large amounts of gravity can bend space, large amounts of gravity can bend time too.
Wow.
And we know this is the case.
So when we look up to the stars at night, does that mean, you know, that star that we think is over there may not actually be there because the photons have, you know, maybe been affected by this force that you're talking about?
Correct. Yes.
Okay.
There are certain stars. In fact, it's typically not so extreme as the fact that we see one thing there, but in fact it's in a totally different place.
Uh-huh.
Typically what you'll see is you'll actually see something twice. It's like, oh, wait a minute, I see this thing in two places. Ah, there must be some kind of gravitational effect going on here.
When you conceive of the universe and moving around it and space-time, what shape is in your mind? Is it a big sphere? Is it a flat plane? How do we get our minds around this concept?
That's a really tough one because it gets kind of abstract really quickly. Because,
right.
you know, our human brains, it makes total sense because we evolved in only three dimensions of space, right?
Yeah.
We call it Euclidean space, right? Everything is very clearly defined in terms of this three-dimensional grid. It's all kind of flat space in a sense.
Does that mean we might not have the right metaphor yet? We don't have an understanding.
That our metaphors are always going to be limited, right?
Uh-huh.
We use them and we use heuristics like any field does to try to explain these very difficult concepts.
Yeah.
But, in this case, you know, to really say that you understand it, you know, would require you to be able to think in a way that you really can't, because our brains don't think in, you know, 10-dimensional space or something like that.
Yeah.
But what you can do is you can use some metaphors that are very instructive to understand why we think about the universe in the way that we do. We know that the universe is expanding, right? This is just, you can look at the galaxies and they're all moving apart from each other in every direction.
Mm-hmm.
It just means that the universe is expanding and it's not expanding into anything, right? That's the idea. You think, well, what's this expanding into? Mm-hmm. Is it like putting a limp balloon inside of a box and you blow up the balloon and expanding into the balloon? That's not what's happening.
It's just gonna
the fabric of space is expanding.
Mm-hmm.
The background spatial metric grid upon which everything rests is being stretched.
Right.
So in our universe, two galaxies that are moving apart from each other are like, again, two pins stuck into a rubber sheet, right?
Yep.
And then the sheet is being stretched. What that means is that everything is moving apart from everything else in the universe. But before a few years ago, one of the open questions was, okay, what is the geometry of our universe? That gets back to the thing we're just talking about. You and I evolved very much in a purely Euclidean geometry, right? And Euclidean means, more or less you can refer to it as flat.
Right.
We talk about three dimensions, but you know, collapse that down to two. Two-dimensional Euclidean space, flat space, means that if I have two parallel lines and I set them going, they will always remain parallel, always.
Right.
They'll never cross over, right? So that's a flat Euclidean geometry.
Yeah.
By contrast, you can imagine having a different type of geometry, such as what if we lived on the surface of a sphere, right? If I am the equator of the sphere, I have two parallel lines.
Mm-hmm.
As they go up, they're going to intersect at some point.
Mm-hmm.
That's non-Euclidean geometry, right? And so for the longest time, we didn't know what the geometry of our universe was.
Yeah.
Then we were able to do some experiments, and it's very clear now that our geometry is flat for the entire universe. We have a flat geometry.
Okay.
Yes. The question we don't have an answer to right now is, what is the shape of our universe?
Okay.
And that's slightly different. So if you know anything about math, it's the difference between geometry and topology.
Okay.
Right. So for example, we could just have a universe that's just a flat plane forever, right?
Yeah.
So if I went in one direction, I would go that way forever, and I would never be able to get back another direction or another part of the space-time grid. If our universe was a different shape, if it's not just like a plane, what if, for example, it's like a torus, like a donut, right? On a donut, you might think, wait a minute, can I actually have Euclidean geometry on a donut? You can, because think about the edge right in the donut. If I set two parallel to their perspective on the edge of the donut, they're going to keep going around it forever, right? So I have parallel lines there.
Mm-hmm.
I can also do around the inside. So I still have a Euclidean geometry on the surface of this shape.
Yeah.
But from our perspective, the effects of that are totally different, right? And this is an open question right now. We don't know what the actual geometry of our universe is. And that's important if you want to control, like, you know,
getting
space
from A to B.
And time be able to know what you need, right? Yeah. I mean, you'd want to control time and space travel in a completely different way if your geometry or if your shape was a flat plane versus if it's some kind of curved topology.
Mind blowing.
Could also be a Mobius strip. That's even amazing, right? What if you go, because you can go one direction forever, but then you come back here and I'm suddenly upside down instead.
Okay.
Totally bizarre.
Yeah, it's like Mario Kart, but I'm kind of getting my head around it. And so what you're getting into there is really about space-time, you know?
Yes.
And this is, I think, a concept that came from Einstein, is that right?
I mean, Einstein was the one who unified these things.
Okay.
Made us realize that we can't treat time as a completely separate coordinate, as something completely different. In fact, it's on the same footing as space.
Okay, and the history goes back before that, but there was an insight from Einstein. So how big a legacy is Einstein left for you as a particle physicist?
The jumps forward that Einstein made are complete. You know, the fact that Einstein has this cultural, you know, kind of reverence around, you know, it's like, ooh, pretty amazing genius, is completely justified in this case.
Okay.
Because his steps forward were so universally amazingly cool.
Uh-huh.
He was able to see these different threads of, like, really interesting, weird things that people didn't understand, you know, altogether, but it's separately we started to understand. And he put them all together in this framework that completely blew everybody's minds, changed the way we think about the basics of physics, and then ended up making these predictions that came true. And they're still coming true now. I mean, Einstein, you know, in 1915, made these predictions about gravitational waves that we just recently, a few years ago, were able to verify.
Amazing.
He keeps doing these things.
So did he have one of these? A time machine?
Well, he may have had a time machine only if somebody from the future went back and gave him one, but we don't have any photos of him with the time machine.
So. Okay. So we don't know if he actually came
from the future. We do not know.
Or if he is just a genius, legitimately. So, you know, do you think we're going to be able to have the ability to travel through time at any point? Is there any conceivable future that you can imagine that has that ability?
I have two answers. One, absolutely yes. It's just a matter of when this will be possible for it to the technology to arrive, that time could actually, you know, time travel could be harnessed for humans. There are currently a large number of extremely difficult problems you have to solve, both conceptual and also technological, to make that happen. But I think that, you know, it is entirely possible in the future someone will be able to come up with a way to harness time, to understand time, to be able to do time travel. At the moment, most of the ideas that we have as to how to so completely bend space-time to the point that you might be able to create a wormhole and make a time machine of some sense are completely outside of the possibility of our civilization, period. Like, humans could never possibly do this, unless someone come up with some crazy idea next week that I don't know about. And I always leave open that possibility.
This has been an obsession for science fiction, going almost back to the origins of the genre. But my question is, like, when we look at something like Interstellar, right? Have you seen Interstellar?
Yes.
Okay, so there's time travel going forward, but time travel going backward seems like a whole different kind of kettle of fish.
Very.
Is that true? Like, when you were talking about being able to travel in time, are we talking more about traveling forward in time and never stepping back?
Oh, no, we're talking about backwards. That's because that's the holy grail, right?
Yeah.
I mean, if you think about time travel forward, we're doing that right now. I mean, we really are traveling forward in time. It's just a matter of being able to control where, you know, how much you're able to traverse, you know, in time distance. Yeah. And in a controllable way. The ways we know right now that we could ever possibly come up with a way to control time and understand it to allow humans to traverse time distances would be to put enough stuff, enough matter density, you know, mass and energy density in one spot that's and make it so collapsed, such a gravitationally collapsed place, like near a black hole. Mm-hmm. That's why Interstellar is a good example. Mm-hmm. That you would end up bending the fabric of space and time so severely that you might have two points in time that were previously just separated by a very long distance. Mm-hmm. Instead, you've bent this the continuum so they're very close to each other instead, and you could, in principle, just kind of hop over somehow. And that's where these ideas of wormholes come in, mm-hmm. where you have it could in principle be an object that connects two different very, very separated points in time, mm-hmm. that then would be close together. You would be able to somehow traverse that, and you could, you know, and how to control that, how to choose where you're going to go, that's completely outside of the realm of real science.
Yeah.
It's just science fiction, right?
So science fiction, you know, what inspires you when you think about time? Like in terms of understanding time, is there any, you know, any literature or any films or TV that you kind of go, yeah, okay, helpful? Or is it all just fantasy for you?
Most of the speculative fiction is very fantastical, right? Yeah. But that's the point, right? It's supposed to inspire your you know, your imagination about what might be possible. And even though it might be a little bit speculative and fantastical in a sense, that's great because that, again, that does make your mind think in different ways. Mm-hmm. And so some of the classics of the genre, you know, still they're classics because they're really great. You know, H.G. Wells is wonderful. Yeah. And, you know, classic movies like Back to the Future, who, you know, they spend a lot of effort to make sure that their kind of logical thought processes were sound.
Yeah.
You know, then it's up to a certain point and then go into the more speculative stuff. Movies like Interstellar, in fact, I quite like a lot because they consulted with experts in the field to make sure the simulations that they were using were accurate to some extent. And some of those are really good. But of course, at all of them, you know, you get to the point where then the physics turns into, you know, it's no longer physics fact, it's physics, you know, extrapolation. And it's kind of the curse of being a physicist in a way, right? Where you're watching, you're following along with some really nice movie, and then they just get to the point where you're like, oh, that could never happen. You know, you even though you want to be a good sport, you're like, yeah, this is great. You're like, oh man, come on. You know, that's one of the reasons why, you know, say 2001 is still such a classic. You know, it's a brilliant masterpiece film, right? And it's never let you down as a physicist because you're like, okay, maybe if you see a gigantic obelisk in space, that's not going to work so well. But like the fact that there's no sound in space, you're like, this is great. They got it right.
Right on. So like, let's project now into the future of time. So imagine that, you know, we don't wipe ourselves out and humans can continue to evolve into the future, or something that humans create is able to continue on into the foreseeable future. Where do we land in terms of time in the way that you see things?
Mm. Again, this is very speculative because I'm not convinced that we'll be able to achieve human time travel, backward time travel, or like far future time travel anytime soon. Mm-hmm. For a couple of reasons. One of the reasons you might say no is that we've never seen a time traveler from the future come back to visit us.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That seems to be sort of a logical and philosophical demonstration that it's not possible. Mm-hmm. You might also argue that maybe they don't care about coming to, you know, once they evolved so far beyond us, you know, in terms of intelligence or consciousness, that they why would we want to go back and talk to those people, right?
Yeah, the dark ages.
Yeah, right. There's the other part of it where, you know, I think that some speculative fiction authors have, you know, explored this too, where time travel is eventually harnessed, but it's such an elite thing that it's only available to the very wealthy and a very stratified society, which is, you know, something unfortunately we have now. But if we were ever able to harness time travel and then make it available in the masses, it's inevitable that some bozo would go back in time and, like, you know, kill their father or something like that. And we would see these effects that, you know, mostly speculative fiction, you know, alternate history effects that would then end up wreaking havoc with what we observe now. Mm-hmm. Things are pretty stable in terms of time right now. So it makes us start to think that time travel itself is pretty unlikely as a physical possibility for humans, at least in terms of our civilization ever being able to harness it and make it available to a large number of people.
Brilliant. James, thank you so much. I really enjoyed that. Great. You blow my mind at many points. So that's it for the future of time today with Dr. James Beacham. Thanks for joining us here in Melbourne, in my hometown. Great that you made it.
Yes.
And that's a wrap on the future of time with Dr. James Beacham. How cool is that? But before you go, I want you. The purpose of this series is to move humanity forward, apparently along a giant Mobius strip. So we'd love to know what made the biggest impression on you from today's conversation. Was it the geometry of our universe, Einstein's enduring genius, or the future of time travel as a thing? The best conversations happen right now, so please get involved and leave a comment below. Another great place to join the conversation and discover more mind-bending content is at futurist.world. And when you're there, be sure to sign up for access to exclusive content and awesome giveaways, including a Super Mario Mobius strip. Don't want to miss out on that one. You can find us at all the usual social media platforms via the links below. And thanks again for joining us. The future is out there. See you next time on Futurist World.
Welcome today on Time Travel Today, or Yesterday.
Oh, that's a good name for a show.
Yesterday.